Was a young man, he never thought he'd see King Tut. People stand in line to see the boy King.
King Tut.
How'd you get so funky?
Funky Tut.
Did you do the monkey?
Born in Arizona, moved to Babylonia, King Tut. King Tut.
Now if I'd known they line up just to see him,
King
I'd
Tut.
Taken all my money. Bought me a museum,
King Tut.
Buried with a donkey,
Funky Tut.
He's my favorite honky.
Born in Arizona, moved to Babylonia, King Tut.
Welcome back, citizens, to an all-new episode of the Batcave Podcast. It's your old bat chum, John S. Drew, here, and this is it. Now we're down to, what is this? This is the fifth final episode of the Batman 66 series. And oddly, as we're coming to the end, we're coming upon an episode that I never thought I'd say I really enjoyed, but I really enjoyed it. And I'm glad to say, for this particular episode, I've not brought in one guest, but two to celebrate this one, because it has a lot going for it. And I hope they feel the same way. Joining me on the podcast this time around, you've heard them both before here. First off, we have author, editor, school teacher, Mr. Robert Greenberger. Hey, Bob.
Hey, how are you, John?
I'm good. And of course, once again, back for another go around, my co-host over on the Hornet Sting podcast, Mr. Jim Beard, the editor, author of Gotham City 14 Miles, as well as many other great works. Hey, Jim.
Hey, John, I want to thank you so much for not having me back on to talk about King Tut again. Really appreciate that, because if I had to say one more thing about King Tut...
Jim?
Oh, no.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's do it.
Here's the thing. I know you say that, Jim, but you know what? I gave in after the third story at the end of the second season. I gave in. I like him. I mean, I don't
okay.
like him, but I like his whole story arc. And when we're done with this, I am sitting down and I'm going to watch every single King Tut episode, because out of all the villains, he's the most consistent in terms of character, in terms of plot and story. It flows. It's the weirdest thing, and I never thought I'd say that, because you know how, you know, when you and I talked about Tut, how I felt about him.
Yeah, I like this episode. That's why I'm here. And you know why I like this episode.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I know exactly we'll why you like it. This episode. I mean, you've got a very specific reason there, which is why I knew you'd want to come on and talk about it.
Well, I'm glad you're both so in favor of it, because I found it actually the weakest of the King Tut episodes.
Fair. Great. I love it.
No, and that's fair. I mean, it's not the strongest of them, but still, in the end, I think, compared to last week, or 2 weeks ago, where I did Penguin with Penguin's clean sweep, I think this one, he gets a better send-off than Penguin does, I think.
Hmm.
That's just my opinion, but... Let's get into this here. The episode's called I'll Be a Mummy's Uncle. It aired on February 22nd, 1968. And we start off right off with the comedy hijinks as Tut is being treated by a sleeping Dr. Denton at Mount Ararat Hospital. And I love this. I don't know if you caught this. It's, again, another little nod to the TV soap opera General Hospital. The establishing shot is from General Hospital.
Wouldn't have caught that.
Yeah. Because a couple of weeks ago on the Penguin episode, we had John Berardino as the doctor who gives the sleeping sickness antidote to Penguin in them. He was Steve Hardy, who was there from the very beginning in 1963 of General Hospital. And I say this as someone who watched the show fairly religiously during the 70s and 80s when they got into their weird sci-fi storylines of freezing the city of Fort Charles into a block of ice by John Calicos.
You frightened me, John.
You know, at this point, we're just so far down the rabbit hole when it comes to the third season. I just laugh at Tut and the whole nothing if I'm not logical lines and stuff, and is loving the Don Juan of S-Wan when they're robbing the Rosetta Stone afterward. I give in. It's just funny. And of all the characters, actually, Tut is perfect for the third season.
What I hate is that he's involved in things in this episode that I normally like, but it's King Tut. you know, it's like, why couldn't it have been another villain? But I do appreciate what you're saying, that it's a story arc, and it mainly is concerning his quest to prove that Batman is Bruce Wayne. And
well, that's not how he starts.
No.
I mean, you know, he escapes from the psychiatrist's office, and he's back to work.
Yeah.
Right. But I mean, that theme, pardon me, the theme is carrying through here as far as King Tut goes.
And the whole, yeah, again, it's like they play up through most of the episodes his, you know, love for prophesizing and stuff like that. Penguin, one week Penguin's in the restaurant business, and the next minute he's doing horses. It's never consistent with those ones. There's just something very reassuring when you see a King Tut episode that we don't get any thrown at any wild pitches with him. He's consistent. The only thing that's wild is Buono's performance.
Okay.
Well, but that's Victor Buono, and my understanding is, unlike so many of the other guest villains, Buono got the ad-lib.
Yes.
Most of those asides came from him during filming, and some of them, I'm impressed, got past the censors.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Well, I've always said that this is a case of a serious actor doing comedic shtick as his character. It's the opposite of Milton Berle, where Louis Lilac, he plays it completely straight, but you know, he's known as a comedic comedian or comedic actor.
Mm-hmm. But see, and I think Jim, you and I even said it in the first time we talked about King Tut, was imagine if they'd gotten a more serious actor to play the role and really played up the villainy of someone who was as horrible as King Tut.
Yeah.
I've always liked
that he has this dual identity thing. I'm curious as to why he is King Tut at the beginning of the episode and not the professor. Like, why haven't they been able to get him to switch back when they know he has to be hit on the head?
Yeah, well, you know, concussions were an issue back then.
Right, yeah.
Yeah. Actually, it's a good question, because at the end of the last appearance, he had got bonked on the head and returned to his professor.
Yes.
And unlike this episode, in the past, he's conscious, like, oh, no, I did it again, didn't I?
Yeah.
And that was missing here. When he becomes the professor at the end, he's like, I'm the professor of Egyptology. You know, what am I doing here? No acknowledgement that, you know, given what he's wearing, he's back to being Tut.
Well, having him as Tut suggests that there's another story we haven't seen. If he got, you know, since he got conked at the end of the last one, and he got conked and from the looks of it, completely forgot. Oh, no, wait a minute. This is where he's going to learn that Batman and Robin are Bruce Wayne. I'm sorry. I'm getting my timeline mixed up.
You know, what's interesting is that he has been in the psychiatric facility, breezes right through security to get out.
Right.
And is immediately put the band back together again, so to speak. I mean, where does he get the hideout? Where, you know, does he call Thugs or Us and get, you know, get me a dozen? I mean,
Egyptian Thugs or Us. Well, you know what? He's obviously spending more time as King Tut than anything, because in the Dr. Cassandra episode, he's locked up with the rest of the villains, but as King Tut.
Oh, good point.
Yeah, which I always thought was strange. It's like he didn't belong in that little group of villains that Cassandra and Kabbalah spring. And he's not in any, well, unless that was a shot of Arkham and we were just weren't told that. but he's incarcerated as King Tut when, you know, we've been told by Batman all along that you know, he should be pitied more than anything.
Well, that whole scene is weird anyway, because Catwoman changes again.
Yeah.
She's not Eartha Kitt anymore. I mean, we don't know who that actress is, but she's definitely not the Eartha Kitt Catwoman in that scene, which I always thought was really weird. You've established this the whole season, and then you pop that one up. I don't know.
That way lies madness.
Yeah, exactly. We'll talk about that one in a future episode.
You know, the show was never strong on its internal logic.
No.
Even going back to the first season. And the third season, it's even sloppier. And you know, I'll bring up a point later. No one was paying that much attention. They were so busy, I guess, rushing the production. Yeah.
But, you know, you mentioned, Bob, how quickly he gets the gang together again. Well, not that they would have really done it either in the two-parters, but we've only got the 30 minutes. There's the economy of the writing that goes on here. We kind of accept these things. Another thing we accept is another one of these shortcuts, because now once this has all been set up, we just get Gordon going to make the call to Batman. We don't see the actual call. Instead, we go to the credits.
Yeah. I mean, once you have Batgirl in the show, mm-hmm. and you have to service her character and introduce the villain, and, you know, there's just not enough time for everything. So, yeah, by now the shortcuts have to be there, especially because the audience is primed. They understand. You make the call, Batman slides down the pole.
Right. And for that matter, when we open with Act 1, we do get a departure scene, but we don't see the Batmobile arrive at headquarters. Instead, we just cut right to the office and Batman lamenting that enough wasn't done to help Tut.
Which is a nice touch.
Oh, it is. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I like that. At least Batman's being consistent.
Yeah.
You know, with his attitude towards Tut.
And, you know, of course, as always, because if it isn't tea leaves or whatever, Barbara learns about the whole thing because she walks in and joins in the conversation.
Yeah, she's a real Budinsky, isn't she?
But that's just it. Barbara has more to do with the episode than Batgirl does, which is an interesting change.
Yeah, and that's exactly what I was thinking. At least Barbara has some, you know, something to do and some, you know, good reasons for it, and her whole background comes into play. But yeah, Batgirl's fairly wasted here again.
Again, and there's been a couple of episodes we've talked about this where it's been more Barbara-centric than Batgirl-centric.
Well, they couldn't let her fight too much. And I honestly don't think they knew how to write a trio like that.
Yeah.
Well, no, as I was commenting on the Penguin episode a couple of weeks ago, that when they did this, suddenly Robin's intelligence transferred to her.
Oh, interesting.
Robin's an idiot in most of the third season, with a few exceptions. He's an idiot. He doesn't solve Riddler's riddles. When in the Penguin episode, he's asked by Batman to look at a specimen under the microscope. He goes, "Looks like a bunch of tadpoles." And that's it. And then he turns it over to Batgirl, and she comes up with, you know, the answer that Batman already knows. But it's like, really? You know, Robin
so
has... Burt Ward got the short end with this. I mean, I know there was always talk of letting him go for the third season, but he really got the short end.
He's become Nigel Bruce.
well said.
Sadly.
You know, looking at the Joker surfing episode when Dick Grayson and Barbara Gordon are hanging out at the beach watching the surfing, you know, it was at that moment they realized, you know, a Batgirl-Robin relationship really could have developed.
Mm-hmm.
You know, sure. Because the actors were of a similar age and look and made a very attractive couple.
Yeah. Although Burt Ward was playing a lot younger
right.
than he was. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, because Batgirl's coming home from college. She's a librarian, so she's got her master's. So she's got to be in her mid-20s. Robin, if you even push it, is 18.
No, oh, yeah. 16. No, well, he gets his driver's license at the beginning of third season.
Well, that's true. Right. Yeah, yeah.
Well, back in the 70s, when that romance actually started to kick off, she had already been a senator, and you have to be, or a congressman, and you have to be 25. So I remember writing a letter to the editor of DC going, wait, she's, you know, 25, and he's still in high school or freshman college? What's yeah. going on here?
And how do we get in on that?
So Batman and Robin leave to go talk with Rosetta Stone. And that leaves us with this scene of Gordon talking about moving to the suburbs.
Hi-ho.
So you made up your mind, Daddy. You'd really like to move to the suburbs.
It might be a pleasant change from my old brownstone if I only had time to find a place. Oh, my.
Well, if I get a chance today, I'll check with a real estate broker or two for you, okay?
Thank you, darling.
Bye, Daddy.
Bye.
Bye, Chief O'Hara.
Goodbye.
And if you ever wondered, because there had been mentions of Mrs. Gordon in the past, we clearly see she's out of the picture because Barbara doesn't say you and Mom have decided to move.
Yeah, that's a really good point. Yeah, there's a whole, they're talking about a whole story that we don't get to see. Like, what happened to her? He has grandchildren. We know this, too. And then now suddenly he's the bachelor father. I don't know. I don't.
Makes you wonder if Barbara came home to Gotham mainly because something happened there at the end of that second season to Mrs. Gordon.
I love it.
Well, it's a nice idea to speculate. My guess is they were not keeping any kind of a Bat Bible.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
So all those character traits, you know, we dropped in as needed.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, no, I know, but I just like filling in the lines and stuff and just every once in a while making those connections if possible.
Third season Star Trek, third season Batman, Daddy's out of the picture for the most part. You know, the man at the top is not concerned much with the show. Quality goes down, things start to slip.
Hmm.
The bloom was off the Bat Rose, down to one night a week. Adding Batgirl to salvage the ratings, which wasn't helping. There was definitely less attention to detail and quality.
Yeah.
The idea of Gordon going to the suburbs, nice touch, but it sets up a series of coincidences that just staggers the imagination.
even for this show, too.
Yes, because of all the realtors Barbara might want to go to, she winds up with Manny the Mesopotamian.
Manny the Mesopotamian.
Henny Youngman doing absolutely nothing funny whatsoever.
Yeah. But I love the character.
Why do you hire Henny? I mean, I can't believe I'm saying this, but you know, why do you hire Henny Youngman and then you just have him do something that anybody could do? Nothing. Nothing.
Yeah, it's a waste, especially with a name like that. But for King Tut to go to Manny makes sense because of the name. For Barbara to go to Manny because Dad just that day decides, I'm going to go to the suburbs, that just makes me cringe.
Yeah.
Oh, no.
I do have to admit, though, again, this is one of those better sets of the real estate office, except for one slip of the camera where you then eventually do see the black background off in the distance. It's tight enough that it looks like an office.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
John, that's really sad.
I know.
That we're down to, it really looks like an office. That's what we're down to now.
Hey,
with sets.
After the High School Musical set of the pier from Nora Clavicle, all bets are off. You know?
You know what? All the money went into the mine tunnel. Set, right?
Well, okay, so let's talk about this. King Tut has decided he's going to build an indestructible empire because he needs the Nilanium.
Yep.
The world's strongest metal. Because clearly they haven't been to the Savage Land for the adamantium. And they you know, somehow King Tut knows it's on this spot of property owned by millionaire Bruce Wayne.
Yep.
And goes to Manny to buy it because Bruce just happens to be selling that, you know, 200 feet of land, I think it is.
Right.
For $47,000. I'm curious how that works on a square foot basis. and it's just, again, these coincidences drive me nuts because it's not good storytelling.
Yeah. Doesn't Bruce say that he was thinking about selling land anyway?
He does make a comment about that, yeah.
He does, and then it's on Manny's chalkboard. I mean,
yeah, but like, why? Why would you sell any of your property? Well, or was it because of it was like a land shortage or something like that? It was some altruistic thing, I think. But
let's face it: the more property to protect your secret identity, the better.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, it all comes down to, I get this feeling that they wanted the end scene is what it was. And from there, they kind of work backwards, I almost feel like. Because you're right. Why would you sell any property that is even remotely close to where your secret identity as Gotham City's protector, you know, is located?
No, wait. You're saying the end scene as in Tut ready to give away the identity and getting clunked on the head? Or
No, just before that. The fight.
Okay.
I get this feeling that this really was just, you know, we're at the end of the series. Because they get into some really wild type scenes. There's the fight scene here. Then we've got the Joker's flying saucer where they blow up the Batcave. I get this feeling it's almost like, let's just try anything crazy to get attention. And I have to wonder, when these episodes aired, what kind of promotion was done around it? Was it, you know, King Tut gets into the Batcave? Was it Batcave blown up? You know, the TV Guide ads and stuff. I just can't help but feel, because you're right, it's pretty stupid, the idea of selling even the smallest piece of property that is so close to your secret identity.
Had I been watching the first run, I would have been a nervous wreck because they keep messing with the Batcave, my beloved Batcave, and they keep messing with it.
Alfred does a great job restoring it in episodes.
He does, yeah.
All by himself.
But let us also let's speculate that this aired February 22nd. By the time they were scheduling the promotion, they already knew the show was canceled.
True.
Pretty certain.
Yeah.
Because they made those decisions a lot earlier back then. So my guess is ABC would not have spent much of anything on promotion.
Yeah, that's true.
TV Guide listing, maybe.
Well, yeah.
You know, they might have done, you know, Tonight on ABC ad, but they wouldn't have done a lot of promotion, as exciting as it would be to say King Tut in the Batcave.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Did you notice also, in those scenes just before Manny the Mesopotamian, how mellow he actually is? Because there's Florence, I guess. She's not his Cleopatra, though. But
I love the name Florence of Arabia.
Yeah, yeah. But she's so clumsy. And that doesn't seem to annoy him too much. And then he only goes and hurls grapes at one of the Tutlings when the guy suggests he go on a diet and calls him fatty.
Right.
Oh, gosh, yes.
He's losing his touch.
Well, yeah. No. There's that great ad-libbed line when she does something to bother him and he says, "No matter, Flo, your assets far outnumber your liabilities."
Yes.
Let us pause a moment to admire Angela Dorian, otherwise known as Victoria Vetri, because she was gorgeous.
Yeah.
Florence, a little more pressed grape, if you please.
Oh, I'm sorry, Poopsie. I guess I got a little carried away.
No matter, Flo. Your assets far outnumber your liability. Oh, that this too solid flesh would melt.
Why don't you go on a diet, Fatty?
You on your diet, man. You don't you mind your own skinny business. Yeah.
And you can, you know, I wouldn't get mad at her.
Yeah. All right, now we know why Tut keeps her around.
Yeah, there you go. There you go.
Now, interestingly, the three thugs, the Tutlings, as you call them, are all repeat offenders.
Yes.
You got Jack Mahoney.
Yep.
Oh, okay.
Who was in the
first
season Catwoman episode.
Yeah.
And then you've got Tony Epper, who was in the second season Catwoman Penguin episode and an episode of Green Hornet.
Yep.
Then Joe E. Tata from second season Pingler Riddler episode.
Yeah.
See, there's a story there, too, that these guys just go around to the all the villains. Who are you with this week? I'm with the Riddler.
Yeah.
Oh, I thought you were with the Joker. No. That
well,
was last
that's right.
Week.
It depends upon what shirt you're wearing.
Right.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. I got the leopard print shirt on. Can't you see? I'm with Catwoman.
And then remembering that your code name this week is Mittens.
Oh, man.
Oh. Now, we do get a Batcave scene before the big one at the end there, where the two are sitting down to a meal presented by Alfred.
$47,000, sir. But isn't that rather an odd sum for King Tut to take?
Yes, it is, Alfred.
Rosetta Stone told us that Tut didn't want to be a pig about it.
Macon. Pig. It's against Egyptian dietary laws to eat pig. Ergo, I think it was a ruse on his part to obscure the truth.
Well, what is the truth, Batman?
Perhaps he intends buying something that costs exactly $47,000. Let's see what the Bat computer has to offer.
Seems a little uncertain, Batman.
It certainly does.
No wonder. Northeast section of millionaire Bruce Wayne's property.
The Bat computer said that.
But that's only partly right, Alfred. I have put a 200-foot lot up for sale on the edge of stately Wayne Manor estate to help alleviate the property shortage.
Jolly decent of you, sir.
But I gave the real estate broker specific instructions to ask for a firm $48,000, not $47,000. This machine needs oiling.
It was never the same after they poured the soup, the alphabet soup into
soup.
It.
Oh, you're right.
It's never been the same.
Yeah.
Now, the idea that they're sitting down to dinner in the Batcave is silly to begin with. And then They don't even take their gloves off.
No.
I love it. I love it for all that. I love all of that.
Never once in the entire series do they take the gloves or the masks off, the cowl. I mean,
That's true.
The Mad Hatter episode, he's wearing a pink radiated cowl in the Batcave. It's like, dude, take it off.
No, Robin has his gloves off. The episode, I'm trying to think, Alfred is cleaning Robin's outfit. And he has the cape. I think he has the cape and the gloves off. That's the scene where Burt Ward puts the wrong glove on the wrong hand and then recovers from it.
Oh, you really got me.
Yeah.
I can't picture that scene at all.
Yeah, Alfred is... boy, what episode is that? They're stuck in something that they would have gotten crud on their costumes. And... Alfred is cleaning the cape, and I think he actually sets it on Robin's shoulders and puts it on, brings one side over his shoulder, and then he hands him the gloves. And Bert starts putting the wrong glove on the wrong hand, but he recovers pretty quickly. He realizes it and doesn't make a big deal of it, and then quickly switches and puts the gloves back on. It's a rare moment where you actually get to see, you know, some bat undressing, I guess, or dressing.
All right.
Well, so you're suggesting Alfred likes little boys? Well, what's going on?
Oh, no, you had to go there.
Oh, Lord.
Okay, so is it I think it's the scene we're talking about now where the Bat computer has come up with its results, and that is, to me, I think the first time I ever saw a flat screen TV in the Batcave.
Right. Is that right? Yeah.
Yeah, I think you're right.
Yeah, now, which is an interesting touch.
Yeah. I also thought it was an interesting touch, and again, it goes up to what Jim was saying about you bring in Henny Youngman, and he's not being really Henny Youngman. The whole scene in his office with Barbara, you know, looking into homes for her father and such.
Well, exactly how much do you have to spend, Miss Gordon?
Well, actually, it isn't me. It's my father, Mr. Rowe.
Just call me Manny. Everybody does. That's my name, Manny. Mm.
Well, my father's tired of city congestion and thought he might make a good deal out here in the suburbs.
Well, frankly, Miss Gordon, if I were your father, I'd just forget about this area entirely. Why, this afternoon I have a deal where I'm selling a lot without a house for $47,000.
Is that the one? Lot $48,000 firm?
Yes, well, I'm cutting my commission to make the deal.
Is that legal?
Well, legal, yes. Ethical, no. But nobody ever accused me of being ethical.
Well, thank you very much. I'll call my father.
Good day, Miss Gordon. Oh, salam aleichem, King Tut. Salam aleichem.
Salam yourself, Manny. No time for pleasantries. Do you have the contract?
Oh, I have the contract. You have the money?
Give him the money.
Thank you very much. Just sign right there. That's it. Right there in that spot. What? No middle initial?
Never use it.
That's what I like about you fellas. No haggling.
It's very, I don't know, I kept waiting for the punchline.
Good point.
Yeah. But
yeah, like maybe a good setup, but not a good follow through.
Right. Well, considering it's Henny Young, like if it was anybody else there, fine. Okay, we get it. You know, it shows that this guy is shady. And if Manny the Mesopotamian doesn't tip you off, you know, so that he's going to be involved with Tut. And sure enough, as Barbara leaves, she sees Tut entering. And she watches as the deal is made, but I don't know.
I guess they wanted, you know, Buono to get all the comedic bits. That's the only thing I can imagine, you know, that they just wanted all that focus to be on him.
And then there's this whole interesting thing, too, because every time Batgirl calls Batman on the Bat phone, she's dressed as Batgirl. Now it's Barbara who goes into Gordon's office, makes the call, and calls Batman. So it's an interesting thing seeing that back and forth. But I'm like thinking, it's pretty daring for Barbara to do it. At least if Batgirl is there on the phone and Gordon or O'Hara walks in, she's like, well, I needed to tell Bat. What is Barbara going to tell Gordon? That she's following up on something she saw and reported to Batman, not her father?
Good point.
You know?
Very good point.
Yeah.
Just,
I don't know.
I mean, it was an interesting scene, seeing the dynamic of the two of them talking back and forth. Because for as much as I would have liked to have actually seen more of Barbara-Batman sort of interactions, the few we got usually were on a very low-key, flirty nature, like the Siren episode and such, where Batman's in her apartment and such. But or for that matter, the Riddler episode, when even Gordon seems to sort of kind of step in when it looks like she's eyeing him a little too much, Batman. I don't know, but I just felt that I would have loved to have seen more of that as the show went on, but they clearly downplayed it from the original pilot, the flirtation between the two.
Yeah. Well, this always leads me to, you know, to fourth season speculation. You know, what would a fourth season have been like, and would we have gotten some of these things that we only saw hints of and maybe would have liked to see more?
Right.
That's a tough one to guess, only because you would have speculated it would have stayed a half-hour show with the same dynamic. And, you know, Madge Blake's not in this episode.
Yeah.
You know, you've got a large cast, plus your need for the villains and victims, and they would have had to have streamlined it in some way, shape, or form, because it really was untenable.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Unless they went through with and hadn't, you know, destroyed the set before NBC made their offer, because NBC, part of their offer, if I remember correctly, is that they were willing to go back to two nights a week.
Okay.
Yeah.
I believe that's correct. Yeah.
Right. But didn't want to spend $750,000 on the set.
Right, exactly. Yeah. Yeah.
Which back then was serious money.
Oh, sure.
Sure. Yeah, heck yeah.
Yeah. So it's at this point then, as you know, the conversation with Barbara, with Bruce or with Batman, that the back computer determines that the millennium is under Wayne Manor, and it also determines that Tut has already started drilling.
Yeah, that's really fast considering, you know, usually you need permits.
Yeah.
Surveying.
Permits? We don't need no stinking permits. He's King Tut.
But that was television back then. They, you know, that kind of level of thinking
sure
was always overlooked, even in dramatic shows and sitcoms of the day.
Yeah.
Sure.
They would just get started.
Yeah.
But what concerns me is that, you know, Batman is very confident. He says to Robin, I believe, not to worry. I had the entire Batcave covered in Batanium, right?
Yeah.
I shielded the Batcave in Batanium, which is even tougher than Nylanium. Not that he's patented it and gotten richer off it or anything.
Talk about absurd. Like, how?
Yes. Like, yes.
How far into the rock is it, and how did you put the rock back? Like, you shielded, like, Robin should have blown a blood vessel in his head just trying to figure that one out. What do you mean? And I would have said, and when did you do that?
When and who did it? And that's when you see a weary Alfred walking by going, it was me, sir.
You don't want to know, Master Dick. You don't want to know.
You know, it's crazy.
Yeah.
Which really, this made my blood boil moment when we are told early on the Batanium shielding is so tough, and then a simple mining cart busts through it and rock.
Obviously, it's not so tough. I think it's back to the drawing board with that one.
Yeah.
I was like, really? The laws of physics just stopped.
Yeah.
I like the mine tunnel set.
I did.
Mine tunnel set is.
I'm trying to think of something positive here. I like the mine tunnel set.
Oh.
And I like the way they. I like the way they film it. You know, the dolly shot of that.
Yep.
Yeah, I don't know. There's just something about that. Sorry, I like that.
No, it's funny though because I'm looking at this and I've got my notes for Act One and I had quite a bit. Then Act Two, I don't have a lot other than some narration because it like just slides on in Act Two. It really picks like almost like a mine car crashing into the Batcave.
Yeah. Yep.
You know, I mean, if you look at it, you got, first of all, Batman planning to nab Tut at the deserted mine on the Soul property before he can get anywhere near the Batcave. But they can't use the Batmobile because they don't want to make, you know, the connection that it's that close. So they run to the location instead. Then we get the foreman of the miners who's refusing to blast the hard obstruction that is keeping them. And Bob, it goes back to what she's, it's like, he even says there's this hard obstruction that is keeping them from moving on and he refuses to blast. So Tut says he'll just do it himself. And that's when the trio arrive and Tut and the goons make a run for it in the car. And I like this bit, the foreman, I don't know, maybe it's way over the top Gotham City, but he gets down on his knees and begs forgiveness.
That guy is somebody. He's,
well, I hope so.
Yeah, no, he's like I forget who he, I apologize.
No, I'm sorry. I got it wrong. It's that's Jock Mahoney, H.L. Hunt.
I was going to say, isn't this the stunt guy?
Yeah.
Okay, this is Jack Mahoney. Yeah.
So there are only two Tutlings, which is Tutling and Suleiman.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
They couldn't even bother to give the Tutling, the other one, a name. They just kept calling him Tutling.
Yeah. So when Gordon and O'Hara show up, why don't they have any other police with them?
They never do.
I know,
James O'Hara wasn't available.
Well, what a great time to have had him back in there. But no backup. Just the two of them. Two old dudes.
They must have gone down the track.
Holy journey to the center of the earth. That means they won't stop until they reach
the bottom, Robin. Until they reach the bottom.
But where is the bottom?
Batgirl, you stay here and stand guard in case they come back up. This time we're going to have to make the 2-minute mark in the mile, Robin. Let's go.
So, you know, oddly enough, and this is, like you said, Bob, the foreman's saying they can't get through the obstruction, but the car manages to... Maybe it's coated with... what was it called? The batanium? So,
yes.
Yeah. Maybe it was coated with it, so it was able to crash through.
Oh, do my old eyes deceive me? Oh, happiness unbounded. Oh, great blobs of joy. Eureka! I have found it. The Batcave, right under Wayne Manor. Oh, dream of happiness.
Well, right under Wayne Manor? That means that... Here, carry the three.
That means Robin and Batman are really Bruce Wayne and Dick Grayson. Oh, the world is my oyster, and everyone will be bringing me soft.
A little winded, old chum.
It takes more than a 2-minute mile to make me winded, Batman.
Let's face it, once Tut gets in the Batcave and he realizes where he is in his glory.
Yeah.
Yep. He's walking around, he's admiring everything, and yep. then he finds the bat dummy from episode 100 yep. and punches it.
Yes. Yep. Nice. See, again, nice bit of con... It all connects the dots. If you go from the very beginning to that episode, to this, I just feel he's the best serviced character. I'm not saying he's my favorite by any stretch of the imagination.
It's always darkest before the dawn, Robin.
I know, and a rolling stone gathers no moss.
And we shouldn't cry over spilt milk.
Or waste time with old cliches.
Where is everybody, Batgirl?
I'm here.
He means Batman, Robin, and King Tut.
Oh, they've all gone on a journey to the center of the earth or something.
The center of what?
Ow! Florence, the fruits of victory are sweet indeed.
Maybe, Tut, but you'll still choke on them.
From the mouths of babes oft-times comes pap.
Are you ready to give yourselves up?
Not to you, bat-dope. Oh, you 97-pound weakling bird boy. And where's your feminine friend? Don't want her to know you're really Bruce Wayne, do you? Well, soon the world will know. You'll have to kill us to keep our mouths shut. Tucklings, follow me!
John knows that I'm in my glory
yes.
when they enter the Batcave. This
yes.
This is my thing, is other people other than Batman, Robin, and Alfred in the Batcave. Those yep. are the stories that and it's some weird psychological thing. Let's not get into that, you know.
So they really hooked you on the pilot with Jill St. John.
Yep. I mean, from there on. This was my focus as a kid, was the Batcave. You know, I wanted to see it myself.
You wanted it to be brought by Batman, didn't you?
Yeah. I love the whole idea of it. And this rare thing in this show is Batman's identity being in danger. Strangely enough, my least favorite villain, you know, is King Tut, who has this continuity thing about, you know, finding out and revealing Batman's identity. And he thinks that he has finally tumbled onto it in the best way possible.
Well, yeah. Of all the villains, he's the only one with a real alter ego. So it's an interesting parallel dynamic here.
Let's have a moment of silence as we listen to the final use of the actual bat fight music in the series. This is it.
Batnasia gas, Robin. You go tell Alfred to take them topside and deposit them on the lawn. They won't remember a thing of what they saw. Roger.
What about me, Batman? You'll have to kill me to keep me quiet.
No, I won't.
King Tut ran up the shaft.
Yes, and he moves very quickly for an overstuffed and unlikely Egyptian pharaoh. We must catch him before he reaches the end of the shaft. Oh, drat! We're out of batonation gas. Now we really must catch Tut before he reaches the end of the shaft.
This fight seemed a lot more violent than usual.
Yeah, I'll go with that. Yeah, sure.
You know, between the rocks being thrown at them.
Oh, okay, yeah.
You know, and pushing, you know, their heads through computer screens. And you know, it just seemed like a little bit more. And as Jim knows, my thing with the Batman series is always the bat fights. I get into it really analyzing it. But it just, I don't know, maybe it was just Batgirl's not here, our music's playing, let's whale them. But it's also a really long fight, too.
Yes.
Yep. Yeah.
You know, Stanley Ralph Ross wrote the episode. He knows how to write Batman episodes. And yet, there are definitely moments where I think a second pass through the typewriter would have made it a stronger episode.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So maybe you could have cut down the fight by 30 seconds and given 30 seconds of funny to Henny Youngman, or more something between Barbara and Gordon about, you know, leaving the apartment you and mom grew up in or whatever, you know.
Yeah.
And yet they had time for all that poetry at the beginning.
Yeah.
We never even talked about Batgirl and Robin, you know, quoting poetry at one another.
Well, the two of them quoting poetry and Tut quoting Hamlet.
True that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. It's well, we've talked about this. It's the same thing, too, with the Green Hornet. Just the odd choices to use certain scenes that other scenes could have used better development over time. It just boggles the mind what they were thinking of. We were talking about one episode where Casey has been captured and she throws her shoe in the water. We're assuming to mark where she is that someone would see it, but it's never followed through. We just watched the shoe sink to the bottom. It's just weird. It's weird.
Weird choices.
Yeah.
Weird choices.
But,
you know, weird editing or scripting or whatever. Just weird choices.
Yeah. So Tut slips away, and the two race off after him after, you know, knocking the rest out and giving them the batonesia gas. And they're hoping to stop him before he reaches Batgirl, but it's too late. And, of course, Tut is more than happy to see her. His voice is getting louder and louder as he's reveling in what he's about to say. And, of course, it's still got to be a comedic moment. Of course, you didn't know, but I know, and da-da-da-da. And the vibrations cause some of the mine to fall in and strike Tut, reverting him back to the professor.
Hey, we really need to call out one of those comic book cliches right here. How can something that big move so fast?
Yeah.
He's running uphill, right?
Yeah.
And he's a big boy, but he makes it quick.
Yeah. Yeah. And as he's running, I do admit, I do like the whole interplay, the switching back and forth with Tut's theme with the Batman theme.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah. Which is right out of the first season.
And yeah. I'm fine with that. I mean, that worked just fine
for
a silly story.
For a silly story, yeah. Now, I've brought this up time and again about the third season and how I find out of all the characters, out of all the actors on the show, the one that is clearly given up, and this is one of those times, is Adam West. He's just whatever. Sometimes he just goes too far with the joking around or being silly. He's not the butt of the joke. And here he is at the end when Robin is asking him about, how did you know that was going to happen and all this?
I really couldn't, Robin. Earth movement is an inexact science at best. As a matter of fact, yodels have been known to cause avalanches in the Alps. A mere sneeze was the cause of the 1923 Appalachian cave-in.
But suppose something went wrong. Suppose Tut didn't raise his voice. What then?
I prefer not to think about those things, Robin. They depress me.
And as he says it, his voice sort of takes on a, yeah, I don't like to think about such things. You know, it's a weird intonation, and his face scrunches up, and it's just so un-Batman-like. It really threw me out of the whole thing.
I know exactly what you're talking about and completely agree. And to me, it looks like another example of Adam perhaps getting bored by this point in filming. He's being loose with his delivery. There are episodes where he just sounds completely bored. But I know what John is talking about here with that weird little thing that he does. It's sort of symptomatic of the third season, where you get to the point where everybody thinks that they can do whatever they want to do, and even break the special breed of absurdity in the show.
Mm-hmm.
with the script. But there was actually some sort of structure to what you could do and not do in this show. John and I have talked about this before in the Londinium episode, when they bring in the mysticism and almost supernatural thing towards the end of those episodes. And to me, that completely breaks the whole Batman setup of this show. But yeah, John, I agree. I don't care for that moment in this when he does that weird little thing, and it's sort of like loose experimentation kind of a thing.
Right.
Not sure what else to call it.
Well, let me jump in for a moment on two points. One, you've got the fact that the show aired late February, so it was probably shot right after New Year's. By then, they probably knew the ratings weren't good. They probably were getting the sense the show was on its way out, and maybe, you know, Adam West was definitely had his mind on other things. The other thing to consider is the fact that it was directed by Sam Strangis. This was the eighth episode he had directed, but he was also the production manager on the show, which is why I think the Batcave fight was so good, because as the production manager, he knew what he could break and how he could stage it. Mm-hmm. But maybe he's not so good with the actors and didn't call West on that odd line reading.
Yeah. In terms of Bat gadgets, we've said before, the third season also didn't really introduce too many. The only thing I could point out is I did enjoy the return of the Bat dummies.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Anything for you, Jim?
I just want to know who gets to fill in that tunnel and repair the hole. You know,
I think it's Alfred again.
It's Alfred again.
I'm sure that it is. Yeah, I'm sure that it is.
Oh.
They're just going to have to abandon that Batcave and start all over again, I think.
You know, it's quite possible that they might have to. Okay, so we've got Joel Eisner's official Batman Bat book. As I've been doing through the whole series here, I've got the trivia question. This is, and I didn't realize this, because I know I've mentioned this before in the past, but this is the only episode in which King Tut reveals his real name. What is it?
Oh, I knew that this is where it was revealed. I can't think of it.
No?
Oh, gosh. No, I'm blanking.
Wow.
Yeah, I don't have the Bat book in front of me. I know heresy, but I don't have the Bat book in front of me.
I could get it, but, you know, that's cheating.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right.
Well, it's Professor William Omaha McElroy.
Yes.
Yes. And as soon as you say it, you're like, yeah, I knew. And you did. I know. But for some reason, considering we've, and as you said, Bob, he's the only villain with a true alter ego. Why that was never revealed before, but I'm thinking about the episode where he's at Yale and the bricks hit them on the head, or not the bricks, the flower pots hit them on the head, and he gets that whole hail, hail, the gang's all here joke in. They never mentioned his name.
No.
Wow.
I think he's only one of two villains in the show that have both a code name and a real name, and the other one's the Mad Hatter.
Yeah, that's true. Jervis Tetch.
Yeah,
I forgot about
say
that.
Jervis Tetch, in it, but I don't think anybody else, you know, has that status other than those two.
The Sandman may have had his name given.
Okay.
Dr. Somnambula.
I always thought that was just an eight, you know.
Now I'm trying to remember if there was a full name, but yeah, I mean, certainly.
Oh, okay. Okay.
And technically, I guess you could say Black Widow. Maxine Black Widow. Yeah,
oh,
it was like
okay.
That.
All right, go ahead and prove me wrong.
Yeah. No, I just, well, I'm one of the few in the world who really liked Black Widow. I just liked Tallulah Bankhead's whole drawl there and everything.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
All right, so the two of you are, Well, we'll say, well, we won't say Batman and Batgirl because she didn't get into the Batcave. So we'll say you're both Batman and Robin and you can figure out who's who. And you've watched this episode, you turn to each other. We'll start with Bob. You say, in terms of an exclamation, holy what? How do you sum up this whole episode?
Holy logic flaws, Batman.
Okay. Now, you started at the beginning of the episode calling it goofy, and where do you stand with it? I mean, do you like it? Would you watch it again?
You know, I haven't seen it in, gosh, a long time. I think I would let it age a little more before seeing it a third or fourth, fifth time.
Okay. All right. Fair enough. Fair enough. Jim, what about you?
Holy poor Batcave. That thing, man. Everybody knows everybody knows what it looks like now, and it's been blown up and had holes punched in it. Batman should have said, "Don't worry, Robin, the studio's about to tear it down anyway."
Yeah. If only. I don't know what the timeline was for, you know, the demolition of the Batcave and then NBC's offer, but if only they could have held out a little longer.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just one of those what ifs.
Right. Exactly. Yeah. I would actually say holy turnabout, because who would have thought that when I started this whole thing, I'd be pointing out this episode, in my opinion, is one of the better ones of the third season. And then I have to say, thank goodness for King Tut. I never thought I would. God.
Wow.
Yeah.
I'm not going to go that far.
He seems normal in this wacky third season. And for some reason, seeing him on the screen, hearing the Batman fight theme, I don't know, it felt good again. Like it worked for me. Yes, there's logic flaws, but we could say that about a lot of even some of the better episodes of this show.
True, true.
To me, I like it. And I've said it and I'm going to do it. Now that we're done, I'm going to set aside time, spend an afternoon, and I'm just watching the entire King Tut story arc just so that I can say, I don't know what I'm going to say, but I'm going to do it. I just feel like it's something that I need to do. I don't know.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, you know, you talk about the silliness of the third season. The fact that the episode ends with the 30-second clip of the Joker and an alien flying over Gotham City makes me already miss King Tut.
Yeah.
Oh, but that's one of my most favorite episodes.
Sorry. I look at the alien and I'm automatically reminded of the later Adventures of Superman episode with Mr. 00000 X minus one or whatever his name was.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I know. It's like, again, is Joker getting a fair deal here? I mean, we've seen Penguin didn't. Riddler certainly didn't. And Catwoman, I don't want to fault Eartha Kitt because I actually do. I don't have that same issue with Eartha Kitt that, you know, like we do with Riddler, where it's like no one can be Riddler because Eartha Kitt made it her own in her own way. But she didn't really go out that well either, considering it was the whole thing with the lighthouse and everything with the two-part Joker story. So I'm just like, will Joker get this opportunity to go out well? King Tut got better than he did, in my opinion.
Well, anything's better than the surfing episode.
Ooh, fighting words. Because me and a couple of other people, Dan Greenfield over at we love the surfing episode. Well, speaking of which, okay, so next episode, Jim's sticking around to talk about this. As he mentions, it's one of his favorites. Dan Greenfield was here for the surfing episode. It was one of his favorites. Does this episode get the same love will he get it from me, despite the ridiculous premise, the way Surf's Up had a ridiculous premise? Before we go, give you a couple of moments here, Bob, Jim. Start with Bob. Bob, what's going on in your neck of the woods? I think you've got yourself a collection of, is it a complete novel of Sherlock Holmes?
Yes, The Further Adventures of Sherlock Holmes, Murder at Sorrow's Crown came out in mid-September from Titan Books. I co-wrote that with Stephen Seville, and That was a really interesting stretch for me as a writer, and it's getting good reviews, so I'm very pleased by that. And then next up, I've got a short story in a collection Mr. Beard was involved in, Planet of the Apes, coming in January from Titan Books.
Oh, very cool. Very cool.
Speaking of Titan, speaking of Bob Greenberger, and speaking of me, yes, we have the very first Planet of the Apes prose anthology coming out in January from Titan Books called Planet of the Apes: Tales from the Forbidden Zone, and very, very proud to have Bob on the roster of authors. We have an incredible lineup of stories and characters and themes. You don't have to be a Planet of the Apes fan, I think, to enjoy this. It's just all different kinds of stories in it, but it would help, I'm sure. Co-editor Rich Hanley and I are so proud of this book, and honestly, the wait is killing me, because I just want this book out and have everybody read the fantastic stories that are in it.
Well, it's got such a strong lineup of writers. I'm looking forward to reading what my peers have done in it.
Good. You should be looking forward to it, because everybody's great. Obviously it's my book, so I might be a big bit biased, but it is one of these books where there's no clunkers in it. You know, it's an incredible anthology where every time someone turned in a story for this book, we were just like, wow. Like, they just topped the one before it, and then wow, they just topped the one before it. Just on and on and on with this. I hope everybody enjoys it. You can pre-order it now on Amazon. Planet of the Apes: Tales from the Forbidden Zone from Titan Books.
Very cool. Very cool. I'll put up links for that and for your Sherlock Holmes novel, Bob. In terms of getting in touch with either of you, Bob, what's the best way of doing that if people want to reach out to you and talk to you about this episode or about, your other works, Sherlock Holmes and such?
Oh, okay. www.bobgreenberger.com, and there's a contact link there as well. So I'm happy to talk to my fans.
Cool. And Jim?
Facebook fan page is the Beard, the Jim Beard fan page. And, of course, you can always find me over at the Gotham City 14 Miles page on Facebook.
All right. Very cool. So, like we said, next time, it's the Joker's Flying Saucer, and Jim will be back to cover that with me. So until next time, folks, thank you so much for listening. Once again, thank you very much, Bob, Jim. Take care, everybody.
So long, chums.
So long, chums.
Thanks for listening, chums. I don't have a bat phone, but you can contact the Batcave Podcast through its Facebook page, Twitter, email at thebatcavepodcast@gmail.com, or by phone at 888-866-9010. Subscribe to the podcast via Libsyn.com, that's Libsyn.com, or through iTunes. The Batcave Podcast is part of a series of pop culture podcasts from the Chronic Rift Network. Find them at chronicrift.com. So until next time, citizens, same bat time, same Batcave Podcast.
Thank you, sir, for calling. That was the president of Yale University, Chief O'Hara. Our eminent professor of Egyptology has completely returned to normal.
Let's hope his ego has returned to the altar in ancient Egypt.
Daddy, have you heard the latest rumors? All of Gotham City is buzzing about an imminent invasion of flying saucers.
Well, no. Gotham City is usually buzzing about something, Barbara.
But let's take a look anyway, Commissioner.
All right. Let me have those. Well, now, let's see. All I can see is sky, clouds, and a few birds. Let's see what you can find, Chief.
Well, there's a blimp trailing some Joker's used car advertisements.
Look again. In this flying saucer, the Joker is planning an incredible invasion of Gotham City.
As soon as the range sweep radar scanner picks up the tracking pulse amplifier, we'll spin back into the substratosphere where I will issue my demands that will have not only all of Gotham City, but the world at my feet. Oh!